Right, we're here with Craig Smithson again. Talking about something a little bit different today, Craig, aren't we? We're going to talk about your exploits on the Hampshire Avon.
Yeah, should be interesting.
Mm.
Should be interesting.
Yeah, something I've got very little experience of river carping, so I'm really looking forward to this.
Good, good. Yeah, hopefully we'll... it'll be an interesting, little chat, I think.
Yeah. So why did you start fishing on the river? Where did it start?
Well, it's probably easy just to start back at the beginning, like most things. Generally got given, I was having a little go on the river, barbel fishing, chub fishing. Some friends offered, had a ticket further upstream that was pretty prolific for barbel, and said, look, there's a gap in the syndicate, would you want a ticket? Yeah, I'll have a ticket. Nice quiet place. And generally it was just barbel fishing, really, and chub fishing in the winter. I'd had heard that carp were getting caught up there maybe 10 years before I got a ticket, I imagine. And they kept saying, oh, you should have a look down there, there's carp down there, knowing my background coming from carp fishing. And I kind of just dismissed it all the time, probably for, I imagine, 3 years, just dismissed it, just didn't even bother looking.
Well, I suppose if you've got access to other waters and that, then just a few carp in a river.
Yeah, I just didn't feel the need to try and catch them out of the river. I bought a river ticket to go barbel fishing, fundamentally, so I didn't really feel the need to go and try and start trying to catch carp. And I just automatically thought they're just going to be like 2-3 like 5-pounders. Like I just automatically just missed it. I thought it's not worth me wasting my time.
I remember river fishing as a kid and catching carp out the river, and they were always small.
Yeah, little tiny things.
And you from match ponds.
Yeah, you kind of say, well, river carp, and you're just expecting like these 3-pound cricket bat common type things. I was like, nah, I'm not up for that. But yeah, just completely dismissed it. So someone who else who's a carp angler, they said, look, there used to be some big ones down this bottom part of the beat. There was like three beats, if you can imagine, down the stretch. And I was kind of fishing in the middle where the barbel were. And there was the top beat, like a big weir that went across the river, then into what I would call the barbel beat, I suppose. And then the river splits into a trout farm and some other little streams. So it becomes a lot narrower, a lot slower, but it is a little bit deeper. And that third beat, the bottom bit, people were saying they used to catch carp down there as well. So it was a summer's day. It was middle of the afternoon, really, and I intended to go barbel fishing. And I was like, well, let's just have a quick look up there. I kind of dismissed it all altogether. And I'm kind of having a little look and see some shapes moving around. And I'm just like, oh, they look like carp. They don't look like 5-pounders either. And there was a bit of a fence over some gates that are controlled by the EA, like big gates on this weir.
Oh, to control the flow.
Yeah, control the flow. And part of the flood defence to stop the village getting flooded. So I kind of climbed on top of the fence. I'm looking down, I'm thinking, yeah, they look all right. There's some big ones there. And I thought, well, yeah, that looks all right. Maybe this is worth a little go. And kind of...
A bit of adrenaline started flowing.
Yeah,
there.
Kind of. You think, well, there's a new adventure going here. You get that excitement in you. You think, well, maybe catching a river carp might be on the agenda. This might be worth a go. It's not going to be a 5-pounder. There were some small ones there. But there were certainly some fish there that I'd have thought were upper 20s, maybe even mid 30s.
Well, certainly
one big one that was a good one.
Yeah.
That was probably that weight. And I think the others were, I'd estimated in the clear water, were probably 25-pound-ish.
Mm. Well worth going after.
Definitely well worth going after. Yeah, without a shadow of a doubt. So I decided to have a little go, just for a little bit of baiting. It was quite deep, probably 10, 11 foot deep, quite narrow. And where I decided to sit, well, seen this fish and decided to kind of have a little go for them, there's an outflow from a trout farm. So you can imagine a trout being fed pellet, and I'm thinking perhaps the scent's coming down this side stream and coming to this area in the river, and it's maybe just bits of trout pellet and whatever's not been eaten off the trout farm. Yeah. And I thought, well, that's probably why the carp are there, because there's probably a little bit of food maybe coming down, and it looked like a really good area to have a little go. And after seeing them there, I was like, right, I'm going to have a go after work. So this might have been, I think, like the start of the week. And just for a little bit of baiting, not much. Cut handfuls of boilies and really, really close in, just off the edge of the bank. It was quite steep. And because it's controlled by the flood defence, it's just like a massive concrete wall for maybe 15 yards. And I was literally just dropping them off the concrete wall about 5 foot off the bank, because it was just a sheer drop.
Yeah.
And it looked, there was a load of weed out in the main flow of the river, and it just looked a bit slack. And didn't look like there was so much flow that had caused problems. and it was fundamentally, it wasn't clear, there was like bits of silt on the bottom, but it looked like you could be presentable with a little bit of bait. So I just threw a couple of handfuls down there and came back the following, like later on in the week, and had a little go, and lo and behold, I turned up and there was some carp there. They weren't quite as big as the ones I'd seen like earlier in the week, but there were some fish like mid-double swimming around. I was like, well, this looks good for a bite already. You're almost rubbing your hands.
Yeah,
it was good. So yeah, really, I've never done it before, and I was just kind of thinking logically how through the week how I was going to fish for them, because never fished for them in a river before. And I was thinking, well, if they've got long rigs, they might be doing me. So I was thinking about like the rigs, and I thought if they're short, then they might be hitting the line and spooking off of it. So I kind of come to the conclusion that if I had a weight further up the line and then my normal lead, then it would pin down an amount of line above the rig. So if they were coming in and moving, coming up on the flow and dropping down onto the spot, they wouldn't be coming into contact with my main line. So I was almost fishing.
Yeah, because if you're fishing off, it's going
to
be going down.
Yeah, because basically my line would be coming down, straight down to potentially a small rig. Because I thought with a long rig, I'm just going to get done. They're going to feel it and spit it out. I'm not going to get any bite indication. So I kind of decided, well, let's give this a go. And having used Olivet's up my line when I've been carp fishing, when I can't use leaders, I thought, well, maybe I can put something up the line and just put a smaller weight there. And I tried just to fly them back some float stops.
Through,
float fishing, just as a little buffer, just to hold like a flying back lead there. But I didn't really feel there was enough weight there, so I ended up putting the flying back lead on there and almost using that as a buffer bead, which sounds really strange. And then putting a back lead, like a normal back lead on it. So you can imagine I've got like my rig, the lead, a bit of line, and then some float stops, then like a little captive, like a little flying back lead butted against the float stops.
And then
a back lead butted up against like that.
Yeah.
So it looks pretty crude, but it meant the line was going to be really close to the riverbed.
Yes.
And I didn't feel that the line, as long as there was like a 3 foot gap, I thought when the carp do come in, then hopefully the line won't spook them.
Yeah, and I suppose that's also going to help with bits of detritus coming down the river, isn't it?
Well, yeah, this is it.
And stuff coming down and building up on your line.
And because I wasn't fishing far off the bank, it was quite awkward to cast. But you're almost like laying it down on the lake bed. It sounds really strange, but you're kind of casting out and like flicking it out. So the lead came down and you kind of got two drops, if that makes sense. So your hook bait with like a little mesh bag would hit the bottom. And then a second later, you get like another tap as the 1.5 ounce or 2 ounce back lead hit bottom as well.
Yeah. So are you thinking about this and planning all this before your first trip on there, or after you?
I was thinking about it through work when things are quiet, thinking how's best the approach, and I'd kind of rigged it up at home. So
before I'd even gone,
I thought, well, this is probably the best way of doing it. I was just thinking logically, how's the best way of doing it. And I thought, if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. I'd just have to move on and we'll think of something else.
So you're obviously fired up for it then, weren't you? If you're thinking about it that deeply, even before you've even got it.
I was raring to go, and I was going to give it a good go. I was going to give it a best shot. So, that was it. So I got some light carp rods, some 12 foot 2 3/4, and just some bait runners, some 60-10 bait runners, which I used to use for smaller carp fishing, although they were still loaded with 15-pound line.
Yeah.
I wanted something pretty soft that potentially is going to cushion the fight close in, but at the same time, there's lilies and bits of weed, and I wanted that abrasion resistance through the main line still.
Yeah.
And I thought using something like lead core or something on the bottom might just be a little bit too blatant going across. So decided just to use fluoro. So 15-pound fluorocarbon straight through. Yeah, with me float stop, my back lead, and another back lead, and then an inline lead. I was fishing it so they'll drop off. And just a really, really short braided rig. So as soon as they pick that up, they would feel my main inline lead, which was like a 2.5 or 3 ounce inline lead, and the rigs were like 3 inches long. So as soon as they picked it up, they were nailed.
So quite different from your standard approaching.
Yeah, really, really different. And I was fishing in the edge, so you could see fish feeding and how they're reacting. And it was really strange because you're seeing some fish feeding around and feeding on the spots. And then almost a couple of trips, actually, I saw like some koi commons, like a bit ghosty in them. Hmm. And there was some fish feeding, and like this common I was seeing all the time feeding, which I thought was about £25. And then one day I just watched this little koi common come in while it's feeding and literally just headbutt it in the side and push it off the spot. And I was like, what on earth is going on there? And I couldn't believe it. And it could only have been because that little koi must have known there was a rig there. And it just literally knocked it off the spot. I couldn't believe it.
It's quite incredible sometimes watching fish, isn't it? How they've all got their own personality sometimes, yeah. And some are more aggressive than others.
I never once saw those koi. There was a couple in there, feed. Not one of them.
Oh, didn't you?
Never ever saw them. Not on bait.
So it's not as if it was trying to push it away from the food so he could, as in the competition type thing.
It just pushed it away. And certainly one trip, I didn't see them again for the rest of the evening. They just disappeared. That was it. It just pushed them away and they just disappeared. And that was that. Gone. And I was just trying to fathom in the back of my mind what on earth just happened. Yeah. But fundamentally, that initial thought about how I was going to fish worked because I did go through and get some captures. That first trip, I caught a common, which was the first one I caught out of the river. Mm. That was, I think it's like an 18-pound one, but it was quite a dark fish, being clear, running water. It was really, really dark. Lovely fish.
And your first fish out of the river as well.
Fish out of the river, and it was it was 18-10. Mm. And I was like, well, this is good. And real good spirited fight, because these river fish, they've got a bit of flow behind them and everything.
And they tend to be lean, don't they, a lot of the time?
Yeah, they do tend to be lean, long fish.
Yeah, and they're used to fighting against current all the time, aren't they? So
that little bit of flow, and yeah, it was certainly good fun, and it was heart-stopping seeing them twist in the clear water and through the stream of weed as they're powering off.
Oh, but it was. Yeah, it was. Do you know where the fish came from?
I don't know. I think further up the river, there was a succession of carp lakes on a club ticket, and they did flood. Okay. So I think some fish came through down there. So there was obvious, some of the fish were what I would suggest to be river fish, long, lean ones, and then quite often you get the odd one that was a bit shorter and rounder, and you're thinking, yeah, it's probably come out of a lake somewhere along the line.
Yeah.
And there is also a carp farm further upstream. So I'm not sure that any got escaped out of that. I haven't got a clue. But I certainly do know these two club waters did flood and they lost carp in the river.
Well, you hear about it a lot nowadays, don't you? With whether it's global warming or whatever, a lot more lakes seem to be getting flooded and flooding into rivers.
Yeah, this is it. And if there's a watercourse there, then they just swim off and down it, basically.
You said you've seen koi in there as well. They probably come out of people's ponds as well, haven't they?
And they were generally small. They were 5, maybe up to £15.
Yeah.
But there was a few. Some of them were just bright orange, and some were like a silvery, ghosty, comedy type thing.
But essentially, I suppose you don't know what you're fishing for, really. You're fishing for what you've seen, but you're fishing for unknown fish, really, and unknown stocking. And
it's a river. There was barbel present. There was chub present. There's bream present. So you could get a bite and it could be a bream or it could be a barbel or it could be a pretty colossal carp.
Yeah. but if you've seen a big fish there particularly and you think, I'd really like to catch that, I don't suppose you know that it's still even in that stretch the next time you go down. You could go down a week later and it could be a mile away, couldn't it?
Yeah, it could be.
You've got otters on the rivers.
Yeah, there's a lot of predation on the rivers. The otters, you regularly used to see slides, often see the odd otter bobbing about in the evenings. So from one season, certainly to the next, if you didn't catch what you're after, you might be just fishing for ghosts.
Yeah.
So, but certainly that first recce week, I suppose, where I had a quick look, saw the fish, then fished for it. That was it. I was raring to go.
You were hooked.
Yeah, I was hooked. I wanted to catch one of those bigger ones just to see really how big they were, and it really did spur me on for a bit of carp fishing in the river.
Yeah, but it did. So, were you actually just targeting the carp, or were you sort of hoping to catch barbel and carp? Because I know carbling's quite a trendy thing nowadays, isn't it? Fishing for carp or barbel in the river, whatever comes along. But you're actually specifically going for
the carp. I was fishing for the carp, yeah. There was, the barbel could get to this bottom beat, but as I said earlier, it was like split into three beats. So I say the dividing line between the top beat and the bottom beat was a massive weir. So you weren't really going to get that many barbel in the top section. It wasn't known for barbel fishing, but that bottom section was. And at the moment, I'd fished in the real bottom section as opposed to the middle section where the barbel were. So I was hoping to catch the carp. They could, the barbel could swim from that middle section all the way down to the bottom. There was nothing stopping them, like weirs or anything.
But they preferred that.
But yeah, they just, the carp seemed to be at this bottom end and the barbel ceased to sit in the middle bit. Mm.
So location was key then?
Without a shadow of a doubt.
Yeah. And how did you go about locating the fish on the river compared to a lake?
It was slightly different because lake, like generally when you lake fish, you see them popping out, like popping their heads out and crashing. Mm. And all the time I spent on the river, you couldn't night fish, but you're fishing late into night, maybe 10 o'clock-ish. Mm. I only ever saw one poke its head out.
Really?
Just one, and that was it. And I was on the phone to a friend, actually. I was like, oh, once she's poked its head out. But other than that, it was literally sight fishing, looking for them swimming around. That was, and that prior knowledge of people saying, well, we've caught them here and we've caught them there. So that was my first port of call. And I had another swim where I'd been told years ago people had caught tench and carp out of the river. And I thought, well, if that's where they used to catch them, it's not a bad starting point. I hadn't seen them in that area at the top either. So that was more of a baiting approach.
So you're using research to show a lot of it?
Yeah, prior knowledge.
I know you showed me a picture earlier of like something.
Yeah, that's some carp.
How you've located some fish in one inch.
So, yeah, this was some carp feeding, believe it or not. So this was actually the close season. This was a week before the season was about to start. And you can just see in the picture, that's the weir that I'm kind of saying is splitting the top beat from the middle beat as such. But just where they're feeding is like lily pads and cabbages and stuff. And it was just like a raised, silty bar. That was just fish.
But it's certainly an absolute giveaway that there's some
fish. Yeah, that kind of giveaway. It wasn't often like that, I can tell you. But, no.
Did they show like fish on a river wood? On top, a lake wood?
No, that top beat, I didn't see any poke the heads out. I saw that once. And other than that, it was just pre-baiting. You never used to see them, really. You'd see the odd one drift around, but you never used to see numbers of them drifting around. And certainly that top section, I caught quite a lot of fish on.
Yeah.
Like, quite a lot of fish. They were generally a lot smaller, around kind of 6 to 15 pound was probably the average weight, and they were all commons. But there was some long, lean ones that you would say were river fish. And some shorter, dumpier, fatter, you fat ones that you'd probably say probably have come out of a lake somewhere along their lines.
But your approach to location is not typically what the same way you'd approach a lake. You're not looking for showing fish or bubbling.
No, it's literally prior knowledge and look at sight, seeing them swimming around.
Yeah.
So I didn't really say, I saw the odd one swimming around up here, but I caught a lot more up that top beat. I caught quite a few. But I didn't really see many fish. You see the old ones swimming around, that was it. But I was investing quite a lot of time up there and quite a lot of bait through the close season.
Come on, tell us about your pre-baiting and your preparation then.
So that top bit, me and a friend were baiting it with the idea of trying to catch some carp. It's an area that we'd been told, just above the weir, people had caught tench years ago and carp from. And it was quite a deep area. It was silty. But there's loads of rushes. It was just above that weir. What's in the picture is probably only about a quarter of the weir. It's quite a big weir. There it goes. So this is the other side of the river. So the picture that we just saw was taken from where those trees are looking at the weir. And this is the other side. So you've got a big salmon run in the middle of the weir. And I was fishing just above it, 30 yards above it.
And this is a faster flowing section underneath, is it?
Yeah, below is the faster flowing section. So the above it was a lot wider and thinner. And this is the weir pool.
The other way around, so you'd expect on a river then.
Yeah, and this narrowed right down. It became quite shallow. That's where the barbel tended to live. So there was reeds. It was all boggy and horrible. It was really a wader job. But there's a trout farm there, and pellet turns up on ton pallets. So I did manage to acquire some pallets that I literally just threw in the reeds, on top of the reeds, just as a platform to stand on when I was playing fish and to cast out, so I didn't have to wear chest waders all the time. And you could just do it in welly boots. So I was baiting that a lot through the close season. I would say maybe between 75 to 100 kilos of pellet went in there.
Well, it's quite a lot then.
Yeah.
And you put bully in with that?
I was putting a little bit, but not much. Just an 11mm pellet. I live quite close to Mark Simmons, so it was just a matter of texting Simo, can I have 5 sacks of 11 millers, please? And then picking it up. And yeah, we did it. I only baited it for probably 6 weeks before the season started, so it was quite a bit of bait in quite a fairly short period of time. But we're going up there maybe 2 or 3 times a week, having a little go between fishing, lake fishing in the close season, and then on the way home dropping some bait in and a couple of nights after work.
And you just bait in this one area? Or
yeah, several? I was baiting about 20 foot long, just in a strip, with the idea of just fishing 2 rods like I had at the bottom section. We were back leads and just 2 rods. But yeah, they all came on the bottom rod.
Oh, did they all on one rod?
All, as you'd expect. All the bites came on the bottom rod. I think I had 2 bites on the top rod, a bream and a chub. No carp. But literally all the carp were all on the bottom rod.
So you could have just one rod fished it?
It got to the point where I just didn't even bother taking the second rod. It was just weight you didn't need to carry. But it was good fun up there. You could catch quite a few. In the summer, certainly they could be quite obliging. I went up there one afternoon with a girlfriend and we had 6 in an afternoon.
Oh, so it's quite prolific then.
It could be. There were some days. I think there was only 2 or 3 trips I didn't catch anything. So it was kind of, I wouldn't say it was a dead cert you were going to catch something, but nearly every trip I caught a carp. So it was quite nice and enjoyable. You could turn up, go up for a few hours after work and catch one.
Yeah, it sounds like a real adventure.
Yeah, it was
and something to really get your mind thinking, because it's different from the normal lake fishing that we're all doing.
It was different from the lake fishing and it was different from a barbel fishing. Mm. So it was a similar sort of fishing, but it was just something different. It was enjoyable and I got a buzz from doing it. It was good fun.
Did you have any problems landing fish? With the flow and everything?
Yeah. Especially up this section, the top section, it was deeper and there was quite a lot of flow. There was quite a lot of weed.
Yeah.
A few of those fish, probably the smaller ones, used to go on some pretty biblical runs.
I thought they got the flow to help with them.
30, 40 yards downstream.
Oh, incredible.
Yeah, it was mad. I did have one that had gone past the weir.
What, at the top?
No, like downstream.
Oh, dear.
got it back up in front of me and then went on a massive run again.
Yeah.
And kind of kited and went down that salmon sluice in the middle.
And I don't suppose you landed that one then.
No, so that was there was a bit of a wood in, a bit of wood, a big branch in there at the time, and it just went straight down the salmon sluice, and that was that.
Yeah.
So held wound down at the bank and just climbed on the grill, and there was just a log poking out, and my hook was just wedged in it. I was like, oh well.
It's funny how they could do that, isn't it?
I think that was probably one of only maybe 3 or 4 that I lost. But that was the only one that went down.
And that's not many, considering how many fish you caught from
there. I was catching loads. Mm. Yeah, I was catching loads. I think when I really was concentrating on that top end, I probably caught... There was probably repeats, without a shadow of a doubt, because you were catching like 7-pound commons and unhooking them and putting them back and weren't even really looking at them. But I'd have
thought... quite a large proportion of the fish are small then.
Yeah. I think I probably caught 60, 70 fish maybe up there.
Quite a lot, isn't it?
Yeah, it was a load. All the time
prolific.
I was fishing
it. Yeah, but that's pretty prolific fishing.
But I think I did 8 weeks when I was fishing it loads, and I did catch a massive proportion of them then. Mm. But I caught some 2 mirrors up that end. One was about 15 pound. And then I had a 21. And then in the winter... I hurt my wrist at work, I had an accident at work, and I had my wrist in a brace. And I thought it would be a good idea to go carp fishing on the river with my wrist in a brace with a metal bar going through it, which wasn't a good idea because I caught that same mirror again. It was like 23 pound, and although it was the biggest fish I'd caught out of the river at the time, the photos were pretty atrocious because I'm trying to hold it, not bending my wrist. And in the end, I took the brace off and I was in absolute agony.
Oh, dear.
But, so that was nice. But then after I caught all those fish up there, it was really the bottom end I wanted to concentrate on.
Is that where you'd seen the bigger fish? Yeah.
That was a lot harder going.
So many down there.
Nowhere near. Right. Blanking most trips. Mm. Sometimes not seeing fish. And I am... After I'd started catching these fish, I was talking to a good friend, we're going around for a cup of tea or a barbecue, and I was saying I'd been catching these carp and bits and pieces, and he had a little go on the river, mainly trotting for charb and throop and stuff, and it kind of got his juices going. And I said, well, we'll see if we can sort a guest trip out. So we'd arranged a guest trip, and we turned up at what I seem to be the big carp area yeah. at the bottom beat, but it just looked devoid of fish. There was nothing about. So we put a bit of bait in, went up to the middle stretch, and fished in another weir, and I had 11-pound barbel, I think, 11, 12, something like that. Anyway, 11-pound barbel, which was good fun. And I was just doing gillying for the day, really, just sat there watching him catch fish. He caught some charb. And then in the evening, we went down to this bottom stretch, and I'd seen this fish, had a little nick out of its tail, common, and I was estimating it was about 25 pound. It was like at the top or end of the one of the better ones that we'd seen down there. And you know what's going to come, don't you? We sat there, and he's had a little bit of a twitchy bite. The tips just kind of bounced a little bit. And he set up how I said to fish, where I've been baiting. And
you're not trying to claim some credit for this, are you?
Not at all. Not at all. And he's had this little twitchy beat, like the tips just tapped. Real crap bite. And literally he's picked the rod up, wound down, and because he's literally fishing under his feet, he's lifted this, and all of a sudden this common's just popped up. Off the bottom, wound back down again, lifted it back up, it's done nothing. And I've just seen this nick out of his tail, and I'm like, that's that 25-pound common. And literally just salmon sweeps it in my barbel net, like a 36-inch net. And I'm thinking, yeah, it's probably 25 pound. I've gone to lift the net out. I'm like, mate, this is heavy. I'm not saying it's 30 pound, but it's certainly bigger than 25. And yeah, it turned out he had a 28 pound 12 common. So my estimations of it being 25 pound was it was a little bit out, but it wasn't bad. Yeah. It was 28 pound. So
I'm assuming you wanted to catch that then.
That was the one I wanted to catch. Yeah. That was the one I used to see all the time. The one I used to see feeding so regularly. And yeah, Wiggy went and caught it. And as much as I was really happy for catching it, I was a bit, oh, bollocks. Never mind. So that was that. So that was my target. I wanted to catch that one because I was seeing it all the time feeding. And then after he caught it, I never saw it feeding again that season. I didn't see it again.
Do you think it left that?
I don't know if it just stretch, disappeared or maybe it got caught and just went downstream or upstream a little bit, but I just never saw it. And then I was seeing sweet corn on the bottom all the time, and I wasn't fishing with sweet corn, so then I thought, oh, there's other people fishing here. So that kind of put me off, and then just went barbel fishing again and carp fishing on the lakes. And I was fluttering around for probably another 3 years, realistically, when I said to myself, look, you need to get yourself together and catch this thing. Just put some more focus into it. Because it had almost been put to the back seat a little bit, and I was catching barbel. And enjoying myself catching barbel, going up and I broke my PB twice in a day, and then the following week caught another one, and I was really enjoying my time up there catching the barbel. And then the next season started, and I was like, right, let's put a game plan together, let's focus, and let's just get this boxed off, just get it caught and get it sorted. So I was where I'd been fishing on the bottom beat, the fish were always coming from the other side of the river where the stream was coming in. So I thought it would be a good idea to fish over there, as that's where they're coming from.
Yeah.
But it was a long old walk from the car park. Maybe a mile and a half, 2 miles, through fields and over bridges and all sorts. So I was doing an R in. Then I heard that you could park in the field opposite, and there was a bit of hard ground, so you could park up on it. So I'd been to France that year, and I still had my mate's boat. So I'm just kind of putting two and two together, and I'm like, well, why walk 2 miles when I could put the boat in the river and just paddle across the river and walk 100 yards?
That's a bit easier.
That's a lot easier. So that was it. Roof rack ran on the van, and it stayed on the van. And yeah, I just pumped this rib up, and it stayed on top of my van each time I went fishing. And when I wasn't fishing, it was just inflated in the garage. So that's what I was doing. I was driving in the field, parking up, putting my gear in the boat, paddling across the river, and then just holding it, pulling it up the bank, and then just walking down 100, 150 yards and fishing. So again, in the close season, I'd put this plan together, and first day of the season come along, and I went barbel fishing. And I thought to myself, I've caught loads of chub, and I had like a dozen chub or something in a few hours. And I sat there and I was thinking to myself, a word with yourself. What are you doing? You said you're going to go carp fishing, you've done all this pre-baiting, you put all this plan in place, and now you're sat here fishing for barbel again. So that was it. I had a word with myself and I really got a bit annoyed. So I packed up and went home. That was that. First day of the season, boxed off. So the following week, I put the plan into action. I continued to pre-bait down there, again, with like 11 mil trout pellet and bits of boilies and stuff. Taking the boat, boating across, pre-baiting. And I caught some small ones, like 2-pounders. Real small ones.
Yes.
And I was catching quite a few chub. And after a little while, again, there was bait turning up on the spot and it looked like it was being fished. Like there was, the grass was being flattened off and it looked like it was being fished. And I didn't want none of that. I didn't want anyone else interfering in my fishing. I was being a bit selfish.
So there's not much angling pressure?
No, there wasn't much angling pressure.
Certainly carp angling pressure.
No, certainly not. And I can only imagine that people had maybe seen me fishing from the other bank when they were fishing. And I don't know what it was, but certainly there was, again, sweet corn and hemp in the edge. And I was like, well, I didn't want to compete with every other people. It's a river. I thought I can just do my own thing and just sort it out. But that didn't happen. So I then decided to move down on a real public bit of bank. Dog walkers, walking past all the time. And had a little go there. It was a lovely, lovely spot. I'd heard that the common my mate Wiggy had caught had got caught there the year before, a little bit further downstream, 30, 40 yards. So I didn't want to encroach on that person's fishing because they were still fishing there a little bit. So I fished, found a little spot upstream, probably about halfway between I'd heard it being getting caught and where my mate had caught it from on the same bank. And
so again, your research has come in.
Research, yeah. And I hadn't seen any fish there. And in the close season, I'd paddled up and down the stretch in the boat, not seen any carp. I was seeing roach and bream and chub, no carp. But I introduced some boilies and quite a lot. I'd been to Milton carp fishing and I'd come back and I had a load of bait with me and I decided that I was just going to get rid of it. And I probably put 5 kilos of boilies in and pellet. Just went for it, literally, just with a big scoop and a 17 litre. And I thought, it was silty and there was a bit of crap on the bottom. And I thought, well, if the bream and chub come in, we'll just invite everything and we'll see what happens. So the next trip I went down, after I'd done this, just poured all this bait in, expecting to see it all on the bottom. And I didn't get my stuff out of the van, left in the car park, walked up, and I could just see two big dark shapes feeding. And I'm thinking, they look all right. They're certainly not £15. I was like, well, this is definitely good. So I went and got my gear and waited for them to drift off. But there was no bait there. It was just what was a silty gully was just gleaming clean in the gravel.
And this is not long after you'd baited it?
3 or 4 days.
Okay.
I'd been to the news agents that afternoon, picked up the Angling Times, and then went fishing. And that's when I drove up. Then I saw these two big shapes floating around. And I was like, cool. It was a Tuesday afternoon. I remember it. And I thought, this looks good. So I went back to the van. And I'm sitting back, well back from the bank on the grass where there's dog walkers. And you can imagine everything else that's around with them. And I phoned my mate. I'm like, mate, there's two massive carp. I'm going to catch one of them. And he's like, mate, I'm at work. I finish at 4 o'clock. I was like, yeah, that's right. I can wait kind of thing. And I just felt I was going to catch one. And they drifted off, and I flicked my rig out and kind of gave it the flick and got both drops on both leads.
Yeah.
And just sat right back from the rod. The tip was just hanging over the bank, and the tiniest of bites, just a single, just a little tap. The alarm didn't even beep. I just noticed a tip slowly pulling down, and it pulled back up again. Then pull back down again.
So similar to the bite you might have.
Yeah, and I thought, that's got a carp on that. And I literally just picked up the rod and hit into it, and all of a sudden, hell broke loose, because I was then stood up out of the chair. I could just see this carp flying down the river. Yeah, that's obviously one of the ones I saw feeding, and it was a good one. And you can see it twisting and turning in the stream of weed, and it did give up a spirited fight, and that was one of the, at the time, the biggest one I caught down that bottom. And that was like £23.12, I think it was. So some sell takes were done. I sent my mate a quick WhatsApp of a picture off the back of the camera, like, caught a 23-pounder. Happy days. But I was like, there was two there. Well, this is one. Let's go catch the other one. I'm just kind of being a little bit sarcastic. And bit of a bravado.
Well, you'd think other one would have gone, wouldn't you, by then?
I'd thought the other one spooked. I thought, that's it, I'm not going to catch another one. And I'm sat there, I've had a, had a sandwich. An hour's gone by and I've had another really just, had a little, I wasn't even looking at the tip, really. And I'm using carp rods, so it's not like your quiver tipping. You're using pound three, 2¾ carp rods. I've had one beep on the alarm. I've looked down and the tip's just slowly pulling down to the water. I was like, there's another carp on there. Hit into it and it went, all hell broke loose. It was just heavy, slow. You know, when, generally when you got a better fish on,
yeah,
it's just a lot more slow and ponderous. But there's just so much weight behind it.
Yeah.
And I couldn't actually see the fish. It was just sat in a weed bed, like in the stream of weed. It just basically gone across the river. And once I pulled it across, I was like, oh my God. Bear in mind, I've just caught a 23 pounder. And I'm looking at this one thinking, that might be, that's getting up there. Like, this is a bit bigger. And I'm seeing it go up and down with rod tip, and it was just all in the edge. So you sat there watching it flanking across the bottom and head biting the gravel, and I'm just, your heart's in your mouth thinking, cool, this is the one I really wanted to catch. And by this time I've seen it's the one my mate caught, and that's the one I want to catch, and it's on the end of my line. Like, emotions are going through the roof. You're absolutely ecstatic, and you think, better not come off, you better not come off, as it's just powering up and down the river, flanking across the bottom, and all the silt's coming up off the bottom.
You just want it in the net.
You just want it in the net. You just want it in the net. And it's gone in the net. And as it's gone over the net cord, I can just see there's a nick out the tail. I'm like, oh, mate, relief. It's done. And I looked at it, I was like, that does look pretty big. After seeing that 23-pound one, I was like, that does look pretty big. So I thought, well, what's the best thing to do? I thought, well, I'll leave it in the net. I phone my mate, and it was like 5-4. And he answered the phone. I was like, mate, I've got it. He's like, what do you mean you've got it? I was like, I've got that one you caught when I took you on a guestie. And he's like, oh, really? He's like, how big is it? I was like, I haven't got to that point. Just like, get yourself down here. I'm not doing self-takes of this one. And he's like, yeah, no problem. So he drove down, luckily, from Southampton, half an hour, drove down to the river. And by that time, I've weighed it, and it's 31.12. Proper kipper.
So a river 30 pounder, there's not too many of those about, are there?
And I think there'd been a bit of banter between me and Staggy sending emails saying, well, I'm going to catch a 30 pounder out the river, and he's probably thinking, yeah, right, are you hell? Like the man's dreaming. And lo and behold, when I caught it, I'd weighed it. I was waiting for Wiggy to come down and do some photos. I'm straight on the phone to Staggy. I'm like, guess what I've caught? He's like, what? I'm like, 30 pounder out the river. What? Yeah, 30 pounder out the river. I've caught that one I want, and it's 30 pound. He's like, really? But I was on another level, like a massive, massive natural high.
Oh, I should think you are. I mean, it's rare to catch a river carp anyway. You know, not many people have caught a river carp by design.
This is it.
And you know, to culminate your campaign with the one you really wanted to catch.
And a lot of river carp fishing is kind of associated with the Thames.
Yeah.
Like in recent years, like Tell's done videos of fishing on the one, then obviously that 50 pound that Nick caught. It's all been based around the Thames,
Trent, and big rivers, isn't it?
But 30 pounders in the Avon, like there's probably others in there, don't get me wrong. But people don't go fishing on the Hampshire Avon for carp. It's known as a barbel water and a pike water and chub fishing bits and pieces. It's not really phenomenous for carp fishing. But that Avon Valley, it's just got real good water quality, and the pits around there, it's good.
Yeah, it's
got
real clear water, isn't it?
It's lovely, chalk stream. But yeah, I was over the moon. I've got a 30 pounder in the net. Wiggy's come down, he's taken some photos, he's brought the wife as well.
Well, his wife, or your
his
wife? Wife?
No, his wife. Yeah, his wife's come down. And yeah, we've all had a bit of a giggle and a laugh and a joke, and he's like, yeah, that looks big. But yeah, it was over the moon, and it was kind of just a massive amount of relief off my shoulders, because it'd been going on. Having seen that fish feeding 4 years ago, I've been trying to catch this thing for 4 years, on and off.
Yeah.
And then finally it's done, isn't it? It's like, I suppose it's like a target when you're on your lake fishing, you want to catch the biggest one.
Yeah.
And you're fishing it time and time again. You felt you got close.
Your campaign's culminated, isn't it?
And it's just come to an end, and it was like, well, what am I going to do now?
Yeah, I've done it.
But I've done it, and I was like really, really pleased. And yeah, it was good fun. It was really good times up there. And yeah, it's 30-pound River Avon 30, isn't it? It's what it is.
Yeah. And it's something different to what most people do, isn't it?
It is.
It's an adventure, isn't it? And it's out of the ordinary.
It was out of the ordinary, and I'd had a good couple of years. Like I broke my PB barbel fishing 3 times, and then catching a 23-pounder that trip as well, which was bigger than the one I'd caught previously at the top beat. So I'd had quite a good year as well, that and some other bits and pieces that happened like about a month before. And it was just kind of a fitting end to what had been quite a successful few months fishing for other bits and pieces as well. And yeah, it all just kind of come to a good conclusion in the middle of the summer.
No, it's
barbecue
fantastic.
Season.
Yeah. Yeah, brilliant. Just before we go on to look at a couple of pictures of these fish, just a couple of questions that I want to ask you just on what you've talked about there. You've got a short rig, but it's got a tiny little hook on it.
Yeah.
You know, it's size 8 or 10, is it?
Yeah, size 10. So it's a size 10 mugger. So I did talk briefly about rigs when we did some weed fishing talking a little while ago. And fundamentally, I said then that 90% of my fishing, I'm using either that or a Lylone pop-up. And that is the same rig, just with a smaller hook and a soft, supple braided hook link that's really, really short. I wanted them, with the flow, as soon as to pick them up, to be nailed. And that was it.
But I would think a lot of people would think rivers, strong gear, because of the flow, weed and stuff, and they'd automatically go for a big hook.
Yeah, well, big hook doesn't mean it's strong. With these a smaller hook, I find they generally go in further. Hmm. And one thing that did draw me to these is I think the barbs on these for a size 10 hook is pretty big.
Right, so it's going to keep
I think. Yeah. So it's, when it goes in, it's going to stay in. But other than that, it is still strong kit. It's 20-pound braid. I'm using 15-pound mainline, and you're fishing under your feet. And really, other than the weed, there's not snags in the river. There is some, don't get me wrong. But where our fishing wasn't, it was relatively clear. So long as I could pull them through the stream of weed and the odd bit of cabbage if it got in it, I thought that'd do the trick. So it was literally a fairly short braided rig with a tungsten sinker in it just to keep it on the bottom. Then an inline lead, fish drop-off style. And then, like I say, some float stops with a flying back lead and then the big back lead to get your both drops to pin everything down
nice and flush to the river. So you're dropping leads again.
Yeah, I was dropping leads. It sounds a bit mad dropping the leads when you've got an ounce and a half lead further up your line, but it did do the trick. It did feel like there was a bit of a pendulum motion, but I didn't have any problems with it. I didn't lose anything because that extra lead swinging around up further up on the line.
Yeah.
But when it does swing around a little bit, they flick off. So then all of a sudden, you're then just left with your fish and a flying back lead, which.
Yeah, so you're pretty much direct contact with the
Direct
fish.
Contact, yeah. And just a little mesh bag on it, a little mesh bag, 11mm pellet and 16mm bait, and ready to go. Mm. Ready to go.
And the other question I've got is you just briefly touched on you using a barbel landing net.
Yeah, the reason I was using a barbel landing net, it was small and I had a deep mesh. And what I found was with the flow, with a 42-inch net, the flow, and because they're so deep, if you didn't get it really, really bob on, you'd be pulling the fish over it and the net's doing this and then trying to pull the net back up was just too much like hard work.
So the 36-inch net's a bit more manoeuvrable in the
So it was a little bit more manoeuvrable and it had a deepish mesh on it. It wasn't terribly deep, but it was basically fundamentally my barbel net.
Yeah.
On again a long handle, but I was fishing in the edge, so it was at extension if I needed to net one at distance, but generally I was just getting on my knees and pulling them right up close and just scooping them up. Couple of foot off the bank, and that way you're out of the flow and you won't get the flow pulling the net down the river whilst you're trying to pull the fish over it.
Hmm.
So it just made life a little bit easier.
Yeah.
So 36-inch net. Certainly filled it.
Yeah. I bet it did. Right, I think it's about time we had a look at some of these fish, isn't it?
Yeah, so that's the first one I caught from what I called the bottom beat. So that was the 18-pounder. Yeah, it was the first one I caught. So yeah, rather happy with that one. And that was kind of what I'd have called a more of a river fish. So although
it's
quite plump,
lean, isn't it?
But it was quite long.
Yeah.
And it wasn't quite so barrelly as some of the smaller ones that I thought were out of the river, out of the potentially come out of a lake previously getting in the river.
Lovely colour, isn't it?
But yeah, lovely dark fish. Yeah, they were nice fish.
Now, this is crystal clear water, I'm assuming.
Gin clear. Yeah. You could see I reckon it was probably 8 to 10 foot deep in places and you could see the fish moving across the bottom. So yeah, it was gin clear in the summer. It's the summer as well a lot of the time.
Yeah.
So it's not like the winter where you get a bit of colour in the water when the river comes up. A lot of the time it was in the summer or very early spring. That was out the top beat, so above the weir. That's another one, like upper double, 17-pound, I think. I think that was the biggest common I caught from the top. I caught a mirror that's slightly smaller and a mirror that's slightly bigger. But
completely different colour, that one, isn't it?
Yeah, completely different. And I always thought that probably came out of a lake. It was a bit dumpier. It was actually quite a short fish.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, went like a scalded rat in the river. Certainly took off. It's a bit of a dodgy photo. This is my dodgy wrist. So that was just under, I think it was like £23.2 or something like that. But that's a repeat. I caught that fish twice. I caught it at 21 in the summer. That's really early spring when I had problems with my wrist. You can see me struggling, trying to take self-takes. And that's after I took my wrist brace off. And I was in absolute agony.
An incredible carp, though.
Yeah, I thought it'd be a good idea to go fishing. It probably wasn't. But
and that's one of the very few mirrors in there, is it?
That was, one of very few. Of any size, really. So I caught that one. I caught another one that was a double. I think I probably caught maybe a handful that were less than £10. So real small ones.
Yeah.
That's a £23 common. So that's the one I caught that afternoon before I caught the big one. That was the first one I caught.
Oh, so that was the biggest up until then.
Yeah, that was then my new river PB as such. And that was probably one of those two fish that I saw feeding on the last spot and all that bait I'd put in the week before.
It's lovely, isn't it?
Like middle of the afternoon, 2 o'clock, bright sunshine everywhere. Not ideal conditions for fishing, really.
Well, you wouldn't think so, would you? But...
Yeah, no, it was really, really good. So it was probably middle of the afternoon. And I think it was 23-12, that one. But nevertheless, size doesn't matter. You don't know when they've been caught. If they've been caught, they were just really
colour,
nice fish.
It's just
they're lovely. Yeah, lovely colour. This is the one my mate caught.
That was not too bad.
That's me. Yeah. So this is the one my mate caught and a guest to. You can see the nick in the tail at the top. So it's quite identifiable when you see
very.
It swimming around. And he had a little bit of a ball patch down his side. And the other side was pretty much immaculate. But that was the one that I wanted to catch.
It's an incredible carp, isn't it?
Yeah, that's, I think it's 31-12, 31-14.
Oh, and you'd be really chuffed with that in the lake, couldn't you? Let alone out the river.
Yeah, that was the one I'd keep seeing feeding and then didn't see for a season and bits and pieces. It really did make me work for it. But yeah, I was ecstatic once I caught it. I was over the moon. It's the other side. So it was late afternoon, early evening. The sun's still roasting hot.
Wonderful carp. But
really, really dark fish. Really dark fish, that clear water and the weed and stuff. But it's lovely. That was the one that was after, so that was it, job done.
Yeah, when you've got fish like that swimming about the river, it's not surprising it got you all fired up.
It was nice. And it was good to see it as well, because I hadn't seen it for ages. And I just assumed that it moved on.
Yeah, moved on. Or
potentially perished through one way or another. So I just kind of wasn't really sure it was still there. I was just kind of hedging a bet a lot of the time.
Is it still there now, do you think?
Yeah, I reckon it is. I don't know if anyone's fishing up there now, but I'm sure that was probably caught end of August-ish time. I can't remember now, but it had been after they spawned. And I was thinking, well, if you caught that maybe a month before, a bit of spawn on board.
Yeah.
It would have been a really, not that it isn't a really nice fish now and a decent size, but I don't know, it'd be absolutely colossal now, I imagine. That was
a wonderful carp,
2 years ago now this summer. So 2 years' time, be another £2, maybe?
Yeah, possibly.
Bit of spawn
could
on board.
Could be a very big fish now, couldn't it? Could be well worth going.
Yeah, it could be, definitely. I'm definitely not going back, though. That caused me a lot of hassle and a lot of heartache, and now I've got it, I'm not going to catch it again to try and catch it big.
No,
and
let
someone else enjoy it.
That's because a suitable culmination to a campaign.
And
isn't it?
I think I'd heard of it getting caught from time to time, and I think it only used to get, you'd get caught once a year, maybe, and that'd be it, game over. But there were so little anglers down there, you didn't know if it was getting caught, if it had been caught or not, or people had caught it.
I'm assuming it's very different to the scene on a lake where everybody knows everybody else and everyone knows who's fishing.
Yeah. Definitely. And I don't think people realised quite how big the carp were there until I caught that, spoke to the riverkeeper, and all of a sudden kind of word had got round and spoke to a few friends and they're like, oh my God. it was good. It was a fitting end to a long trip, but it's done the trick. So I see that now. I'm still like, really,
it still does it for me, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. Yeah. Like if I thought that it might have been gone or a different bait, like it gets me going now. Like if I could go up the river now and see if find another stretch and find some carp, I'd definitely go for it again.
You'd go for it again.
100%. Yeah, definitely. It's pretty inspiring. Yeah, it was good.
That's brilliant, Craig. Thanks ever so much for coming in and telling us about that. Really interesting and, yeah, just something a little bit different.
Yeah, slightly different. Good to come up. Nice to see you again, Matt. I suppose next time I see you, we might be on Bloomere.
Yes, the Garden Social again. Yeah. Looking forward to that.
Cool. Thanks, Craig. Catch you soon.